Now we are going to continue our yesterday discussion about marine seismic acquisition. Yesterday we were speaking about the importance of the positioning system and how it is very important to pin the hydrophones in their respective and their accurate positions, because having erroneous locations will result in erroneous representation or modeling of the subsurface structure. Here, at the upper right, we have the vessel at the upper top upper part, towing the stream, which is a collection of hydrostatic or hydrophone sensors. This hydrophone sensors is housed in a streamer, and as you see, the streamer do not follow straight line, but yet there is certain deviation from the straight line expected to be. So we can say that streamers do not follow a straight line, but cross currents causes them to move snake-like. And the snake-like movement is called feathering. This deviation is estimated to be due to be few degrees from the sailing line. Sailing line is the direction of the vessel, the sailing of the vessel. So it's deviated a little from the sailing line of the vessel. This situation is very very problematic for 3D processing, for 3D investigations. So we need to solve this problem. The solution could be using either steering or multiple vessels, instruments that try to straighten or to reduce the deviation from the line of sail, and also to produce the accurate position of the hydrophones we are using. So the most important thing, we have two most important points to consider. The position of the source is very important, and the hydrophone positions are also important. Why these are important? Why the position of the source and the position of the hydrophone is important? It is very important because all our work is directed or focused on tracking or tracing the wave from the source to the receiver. By knowing the position of the source and the position of the receivers, we can deduce the trace or trace the way the wave field interact with the subsurface. So if we lost the accurate location, so we also lose the model itself, because we are not sure where the shot was and where the receiver was. We can try to draw something that might help to understand this. Okay, now this is the surface, whether land surface or marine surface. Now we suppose we have reflection coming from point from the subsurface here. So all our work is directed in collection, collecting the CMB, common midpoint, and to estimate these lenses to estimate the travel time. Then to correct this travel time into zero offset time, then we end up with our trace. Okay, so the number of traces produce our seismic section or seismic cube. So, and if this the point of start and the point of end is not accurately known, so this measure, the measure of these lenses, will also not accurately known, and also the position of the common midpoint will also not accurately known. So all the modeling we are doing will be erroneous, and we end with zero output. That's why we are very, very focusing on positioning our instrument, either on land or in offshore. In both cases, defining the start and end is very important. In addition to the timing, because timing should be very, very accurate. So the clock itself should also be accurate, because now in this case we work on milliseconds. So if we have errors in milliseconds, we might have erroneous data, erroneous estimate. For example, if I'm having say 0.2 millisecond error, and suppose the B wave velocity is 3,000 meter per second, so the error in depth will be 3,000 times 0.2 times 10 to the power minus 3, which will become about, no, it will be very small here, if we suppose it's 2. So it will be about 66 meters error. So we have to be sure to accurately adjust our timing system to accurately pick our marker so that we get accurate result at the end. We have seen this before yesterday. These birds have two uses. The first one is to try to keep the depth of the hydrophone or the streamer, to keep the depth at certain level. So when it is going deeper, the bird, it's like the airplane wings, move so that it will float upward. When it's going shallow, it will also move its wings to go down. Also, these birds are used to measure the deviation of the streamer during its exploration course. Now, leaving the positioning and moving to new new item that we are going to speak at the end of, to discuss at the end of this course, which is the AVO, which is amplitude versus offset, what one of the important seismic attributes. For quantitative imaging, we usually interested in long offset reflections, which contains valuable AVO information. This is a reflection coefficient, which is a function of the angle of incidence, function of theta, which equal r of zero, which is the normal incidence, plus g sine square theta. This relation is used with modeling to delineate the lithology, to delineate the fluid content. When we come to this point, we'll understand the number we have about four classes. We're going to speak about when we have the value of the intercept and the value of the slope is something. We have, say, gas, we have water, fresh water, or so on. So this information may not be in the short offsets, which result in small angle reflections. Long offsets, together with the refracted energy, may compensate, which means overcome, lack of low frequency in waveform inversion. Now we have the term of waveform inversion. The waveform inversion is try to invert the record you have to obtain the velocity and other parameters of the subsurface. So here in waveform inversion, we are not dealing only with time. Most of our discussion were directed or focused on analysis of time. We touched the wave equation once when we speak about Kirchhoff migration. So I have time space analysis, and in this analysis I am not interested in amplitude. So all I'm interested in is the time to pick the onset or to pick the marker or the reflectors from the seismic section. However, the amplitude itself has valuable information about the lithology and about the fluid content. So we have another task, which is called waveform analysis, in which we have both time and amplitudes are encountered. We also use the equation, the wave equation, which is partial square u bar partial x square equal 1 c square u bar partial t square. This is the, what you can say, one-dimensional wave equation if x is non-space, but if x is x1, x2, x3, so it is the general form of the wave equation. Here, C represents the wave speed. This is the wave velocity. And here, of course, we are dealing with both time and amplitude. Here, U represent, U is a function of, this is amplitude function of T and X. Or more specifically, X and T. Yes, yesterday we stopped at this slide, which is multi-azimuth, and why, what is multi-azimuth, and why it's important, and why also, what also is the spherical coordinates, which is r, theta, and alpha, and we have also this polar projection. So, what is the spherical coordinates? Do you have any idea about spherical coordinates? Now we have the Cartesian coordinates, x, y, and z. Spherical coordinates is another kind of coordinates. Here, this is r from the origin, pointing from the origin in any in the surface of the sphere. This is r, and this angle with the horizontal plane is theta. And the angle with the vertical plane here is phi. Okay, so these are r, theta, and phi, which is a component. It's another way of representing objects. If we are assuming we are moving in sphere, like the Earth itself. If you assume the Earth is a perfect sphere, so if I want to put myself to define the place of myself, so I am at distance r, which is the radius of the Earth from the center, at angle theta. Here the angle theta will be the latitude, okay? And with angle, sorry, the angle phi is not, it's not, sorry. Okay, I'm sorry. This is the angle theta, which is the horizontal angle, okay? This is the angle theta, horizontal angles measured from north. Sorry. Theta, okay? So this is a horizontal angle. So this may represent longitudes. And the angle phi, this angle may represent the latitudes. Moving up and down and moving in horizontal direction. So this vector, when it moves in all direction, it plot the surface of a sphere. So we have phi and theta here representing the latitude and longitude in my case. Okay? Shall we proceed? The projection generally is used to project objects that are not included in, say, in flat plane, into the plane. So if you are projecting points from the Earth, you cannot just put this value on a plane. You will lose the directions, the effective directions, and the spatial relation between these points. And I have an experience I want to share with you that may clarify this. In year 2000, I went to United States in a scientific mission, and there I want to pray. So I was in California, it's 35 degrees, and Mecca, according to my thought, was that to the south east of my place. So I started praying in the south east direction. But when I went to mosques, I realized they are praying in other directions, they are praying in north direction. So I went to the internet and searched it. When you project, if you have here, this is the Earth. Suppose this is a complete sphere, and suppose here is Mecca, then we have to be in circles around Mecca. But when you try to project this sphere into plane, this circle becomes something like that. And near here, and then it will deviate something like that. So, and for people here at my place, you should look to the north, which is the proper locate the proper direction to circles around Mecca. So this is projection, and this is important not only for praying but for our work, especially if our work is regional, meaning we have what we are working with distance, say greater than 1,000 kilometers. Because for a small distance, the surface of the Earth becomes less deviated from the spherical plane. But when we are at longer distances, we have to take care of the curvature of the surface of the Earth, because the directions and the spatial relation between the points will change also. Now we have this, we have the subsurface is illuminated uniformly like a CT X-ray scanner. So I'm telling you, as a geophysicist, especially who works in seismic, we are like the people, the doctors or the medical doctors. But here our patient is the Earth, not the human. So now this is a CT scan. When the structure is subjected to X-ray, complex structure illuminates, reflects energy in all directions. So if you are going to observe this reflection in single azimuth, you will gain information, but you will not gain all the information needed. Here we have an example that we have single azimuth here in west-east direction. Here the image, as you see, we have low information about some parts of the region. Another azimuth here, which is south-north direction, and as you see, we have some black areas with no information. But when we incorporate the whole or north-south and east-west azimuth, we have the whole pictures. So, in our work, we are interested in multi-adimus analysis, which means we record the structure, we record the subsurface, this area, with multi-azimuths in this direction, and this, then in this direction, and then in that direction. Azimuths, some of your colleagues asked me before, azimuth means angle of direction. So this is the angle of direction, this is the angle of direction, and so on. How we measure azimuths? The azimuth is a direction measured from the geographic north direction in a clockwise sense. Measured from the geographic north direction in a clockwise sense. Okay? You know, the clock moves in this direction. So I'm measuring azimuth in this direction. Azimuth range from zero to a complete cycle, back at zero or 360 degrees. Okay? So for this, you can say this is zero azimuth, if this is the direction of the geographic north. This, say, is 45 degrees. Here we are not speaking about east or west, because azimuth itself is sufficient to define the direction. This is about 135 degrees in azimuth. Okay? And as we have any problem? And as we said, this type of multi-azimuth acquisition is useful for challenging structures like salt domes. I guess you have idea about the problem of salt domes. For salt domes tends to mask or to prevent energy, seismic energy, from penetrating deeper. So in areas with salt domes present, it's very difficult because the energy is scattered and we cannot have good cross seismic section in this area. So using multi-azimuths would help us to overcome this problem. Here in Egypt, we have, in the Gulf of Suez, we have the problem of salt domes in some places, and we use something like that. Now I have another example from the North Sea. North Sea is, I guess it's in the vicinity of Britain, Great Britain. So the upper part is the ray tracing head density maps for different shooting direction. The first one is east-west shooting, the second one is north-east-south-west shooting, and the third one is north-west-south-east shooting. As you see, by changing the direction, we have new information. Also, we have the offset distribution for different modeled shooting directions. We have in the lower panel the east-west only, and then east-west, north-south, and then east-west, north-south, plus 150 degrees azimuth. Okay? You can realize these colors by observing the color scale, which either represent the velocities, or in some cases represent deviation of the velocities. If we are having a tomography, we usually say this this layer is of velocity, say 3,000 meters per second. But in tomography, we obtain the deviation or variation from this average velocity. Okay, so this represents the change in lithology, the change of in conditions throughout the spatial distribution of the layer. We'll have discussion about tomography and the governing equations for tomography. Also, another example, we have here this, the three azimuths, and this one is a single azimuth. Quantitatively, you can see that the structures here are missed or aliased in the other direction. Also, some structure here is not present in this part. In the color map, the situation is more clear, as you see. The structures in this part is totally missed here, and also the structure in the southern part are simplified here. It's not as detailed here as this detailed, and this is less detailed. This slide is another example to show the effect of ghosts and the effect of sea bed or water layer multiple. Now we have ghost here, and also we have ghosts when the energy move beyond the hydrophones and then reflected back, and so on. Excuse me. Okay, so this blue line represent multiples, and also this red line goes down into the Earth's material. This is surface seabed reflection, and also we have this reflection, which is become a ghost, and then the ghost become multiples again. Do you know this? This effect. Is there something? This effect helped the sea animals like whales and fish and so to communicate for long distances, because the energy here is multiplied, or in other words, keeps amplitude, so whales can send the messages for hundreds of miles using this, or they call the channels. So the seismic is a little bit can help also in environmental tasks, like detecting the signals from whales and so on. Now we are moving to two comparison between two-dimensional and three-dimensional seismic surveys. As you see, for two-dimensional, I'm cutting the survey area with single stream, but here we are sweeping the area with multiple stream single navigation. But this is not only the important thing, but also we have, for complex structure, we have problem of obtaining good models from the subsurface using 2D. Why? I told you before. because we have the off-plane reflections, reflections coming from points outside the plane of the profile. In this case, these points, when I am trying to locate or to put on the profile, I am producing virtually fake reflectors. It's not the true reflector because the point is not in the same track or in the same plane of my profile. Also, some of the points in my profile, we always suppose we have the dipping in the same plane of my profile. Suppose I'm moving accidentally on the strike. So, do you remember what a strike is? What is a strike? This is from secondary or high school, maybe. Strike. What's a strike? The geology people should know what is a strike. It's not a direction. For a dipping layer, okay, to define the surface of a dipping layer, you define this surface by the intersection of the horizontal plane with this plane, which is a straight line at constant elevation from the sea level. This line is called strike. This is a dipping layer, and here are the strikes. Horizontal lines with constant elevation from the sea level. So you may say this 100 meters, this 200 meters, this 300 meters, and so on. The dip along the strike is, anybody know, the dip along the strike? Dip. The dipping along the strike. What is the angle of dip along the strike? If you are moving along the strike line, You should use your brain. We just said that the strike line represents points of constant elevation from the sea level. So if I'm moving along the strike, the dip will be zero. I'm moving at the same elevation. There is no change in elevation. Moving in this direction, all at 200 meters. Okay? But the perpendicular to the strike, the perpendicular direction to the strike is called the true dip. True dip of the tilted layer or dipping layer is measured perpendicular to strike. I saw many FYB of you working in geology. This is the starting point. Strike and dip, you should measure the strike and dip. Where is those people who were working in their FIB? Yes, you should even yes. You Atiq, I guess you and Khairun Nisa and. But you are working in you are working on joints. Yes, but you should this is elementary. It's very important for you. It's elementary. Suppose you know how is my, what is migration, how we apply migration, and how we apply waveform inversion, but the person interviewing you asked you what is a strike, and then it will be catastrophe. Apparent depth is any angle other than the 90 degree from the strike edge. Okay? So, if I am moving on the surface in the strike direction and the energy come here, it will be reflected off the plane. Okay? And some other point from up dip will come to my record, which means we have difficulty in identifying this layer or this structure. Please review the elementary concepts. Okay, this is another example of 3D observations. As you see, this is a full fold area, which means the maximum. If I take the number of folds, which the number of times and energy come from common midpoint of the subsurface, we'll find at the border small number, and then at certain point we have the maximum number of folds, and then the number of folds fold down again. Folds mean the number of traces, the number of common midpoint traces. So this ratio here is represented by the fold area, and then this is fold taper. If you remember the tapering, this is the taper shape. Now, for imaging deep, energy sampled at long distances come from deeper regions, which means if I'm looking forward to getting reflections from deeper interface, I should have longer streamers. Now we have an idea about the measurements we have. This, the right-hand side panel represents the distribution of P-wave velocity with depths. The right-hand side represents the reflection we gain, and so this one is related to this large change in P wave velocity, so we have high energy reflected, and then we have, due to the change here for this one, smaller, and here another smaller, but with different, you have to see different polarity, and then we have other arrivals from velocity change, and then at this point where we have high velocity change, we have this actually should be two reflectors. That's why we are looking for impulsive source. So these two represent two reflectors, and then the rest of our data. So to move from depth to time, you subdivide this depth by the velocity. To move from time to depth, you multiply time to velocity. And keep in mind that we are here, we have two-way time, so we have to half the time before multiplication. Here another some example about marine seismic survey. So the other part represent the sea. We have small, we have delay energy of energy coming from the sea. But now at the lower part, you may realize that we have multiples. So one of our task here is to remove this multiples. This is another example for long offset data. So we increase the length of the record of the streamer. So we are going deeper in time, and also we have information about deeper structure. Excuse me? This? Yeah, this energy we have here, here we have reflections. You mean here? This is a two-way time. This is a two-way time. And this is the receiver direction. So this is another example of deep seismic sections. These two samples taken from marine seismic. The upper part represent, this is the layer, the water layer. And here we have migration at two sections, trying to achieve information about deeper structures. The vessel, we have this, some information. The vessel may have this values. We have length of 84 meters, the beam 18.5 meters, draft 6.2 meters, displacement 5,600 metric tons, cruising speed 13.5 knots, berth 50, endurance at sea 50 days. We have other marine sources. We have water guns. Water guns is similar in, to air gun, but with the water replacing air. But the air water gun is weaker, and we have lag and low frequency part. Marine vibrator, some instrument like the land vibrator, but alternating motor, either electric or hydraulic, with a blade immersed in the, into the water, and then it makes sweeps, say from 10 to 80 hertz over 10 seconds interval. Of course, we should remove the effect of the source to see something, or to see that the seismic section. Without removing these sweeps, you see nothing. We have also another marine seismic technique. There is many techniques, but here we have a seabed recording system which make use of OBS, which is ocean bottom seismometers, attached to ocean bottom cables, and this is dragged by the vessel. In early days, ocean bottom seismograph were only used for university research work, not directed to marine, but in some cases it's used for marine seismic exploration. Thank you.